lecture, we are going to discuss about the interaction of gamma rays with matter. In the previous lectures, we have discussed about the interaction of heavy charged particle and the interaction of light charged particles with matter. So there we saw that the two main processes by which the energy is lost, in the case of heavy charged particle, it is the collisional loss. And in the case of light charged particles, it is both the collisional loss as well as the radiation loss. Now the gamma radiations, here we are going to talk about the gamma radiations. Now the gamma radiations, their properties are completely different from the heavy charged particles and the light charged particles. The gamma radiations, they are uncharged. So these are the neutral radiations, they do not have any charge, therefore their interaction with the matter is also completely different. So the gamma rays originate from the nucleus, as we have studied in the previous semester that gamma radiations, they are emitted when the nucleus makes a transition from one energy state to the another energy state, when the nucleus de-excites from a higher excited state to the lower energy state, then gamma radiations are emitted. So their origination is from the nucleus. So the gamma radiations are uncharged and hence their interaction with the matter is also completely different. So there are three main processes by which the gamma rays interact with matter. The first one is the photoelectric effect. Second one is the Compton scattering. So these are the processes by which the gamma radiations will lose their energy inside the matter. So first one is the photoelectric effect, second is Compton scattering, and last one is the pair production. The gamma photon loses either its total energy or a part of its energy to the electron of the medium. So these gamma radiations, the gamma photon, let's say it has energy of h nu, so nu is the frequency of the photon, so h nu is the energy which is carried by this gamma photon. So either whole energy of the gamma photon is taken away by the electron with which the gamma photon is interacting, or a part of its energy is taken by the electron. So in the case of photoelectric effect, whole energy of the gamma photon is given to the electron. In the case of Compton scattering, a part of the energy of the gamma photon is given to the electron with which this gamma photon is interacting. Now, first of all, we are going to discuss about the photoelectric effect. Now, photoelectric effect always occurs with the bound electron. An electron which is bound with the nucleus. So this photoelectric effect always occurs in that system only in which the electron is bound with the nucleus. So let's say this is some atom of the medium. So gamma rays, they are traveling inside the medium. So this medium or the matter, it will contain large number of atoms. So let's say this is one of those atoms. So it has a nucleus and there are electrons which are revolving in the orbits of the atom. So these electrons, they are bound with the nucleus. So these are the bound electrons. So now what happens when a gamma photon falls on this electron? Let's say this is the first orbit, or you can say the K shell. So this is the K shell electron. The photon falls on this, it interacts with this electron. So what happens in that case? So let's say the energy of this photon is h nu. Nu is the frequency of this photon. Now these electrons, they are bound with the nucleus. As we know that every electron has some binding energy. Every electron which is present in the orbit has certain binding energy, means some amount of energy must be given to this electron so that it can be made unbound from the nucleus. So this electron is bound with the nucleus, therefore some amount of energy must be given to the electron so that it goes out of the vicinity of this nucleus, means it is no more bound with this nucleus. So therefore the concept of binding energy comes. So there is a binding energy of every electron. So some sort of energy must be provided to the electron so that it can be made free. So there is a binding energy of K shell, as well as there is a binding energy of L shell, and so on. So there is a binding, certain binding energy of associated with every orbit or every shell. So the photon which is interacting with this electron, so it has certain amount of energy. Now this electron is bound with the nucleus, and we know that to make this electron free, it requires certain amount of energy, and that is called as the binding energy. So from this energy of the photon, the incoming photon, from this energy of the incoming photon, some part of the energy will be used by this electron to get unbound. So let's say this electron requires binding energy, certain binding energy, to be free from the nucleus, to be free from the force of the nucleus. So from this energy of the incoming photon, this much energy, whatever is this energy, this much energy will be utilized by this electron to get free from the force of the nucleus. And the rest of the energy of the photon will be given to the electron as its kinetic energy. So the energy which is taken away by the electron, the kinetic energy which is taken away by the electron, is nothing but the total energy of the photon, which is h nu, and some part of this energy is used to make this electron free from the force of the nucleus, and that is binding energy. So from this h nu, some amount of energy will be utilized to make the electron free, and rest of the energy will be given to the electron, to this electron, as its kinetic energy. So the photon, this photon which is incoming photon, it will disappear, and its energy will be used in two forms. First, it will be used to make the electron unbound, to make the electron free, and the other portion of this energy will be given to the electron as the kinetic energy. So the kinetic energy of the electron will be nothing but h nu minus the binding energy of the electron in the orbit. So this much amount of energy is given to the electron as its kinetic energy. So in the case of photoelectric effect, whole energy of the photon is given to the electron. So whole of the energy is given to the electron. So this is utilized, whole of the energy of the photon is utilized in the photoelectric effect. So this similar thing you have studied in the case of a conductor. So let's say if you have a conductor and you make some photons of energy h nu to fall on this conductor. And we know that the conductor has certain electrons, it has large number of electrons, and we call them as the free electrons. But these electrons, they are bound to the surface of the conductor with certain amount of energy, and that we call as the work function, which is usually represented by phi. So this much energy, work function, this much energy is required for these electrons to get unbound from the surface of the conductor. So some amount of energy is still required by the electrons in the conductor to get free from the surface of the conductor, and rest of the energy from this h nu. So a part of the energy of the incoming photon will be used to make the electron free from the surface, to bring the electron out of the surface of the conductor. And rest of the energy will be given to the same electron as its kinetic energy. So when a photon of energy h nu falls on the electron ejects out of the surface of the conductor, and by utilizing phi amount of energy. So from this h nu energy of the photon, phi amount of energy is used to make the electron, to eject the electron from the surface of the conductor, and rest of the energy will be given to this same electron as its kinetic energy. So kinetic energy of the electron in the case of a conductor, that is equal to h nu minus the work function. So this is the concept that you have already studied in the case of conductor, the photoelectric effect in the case of a conductor. So this same thing happens in the case of atom also. in the case of the material medium. So when the gamma rays they are traveling in the medium, they can interact via photoelectric effect. That is, they will interact with the bound electrons, and these electrons they will get knocked out of the atom, and they will carry some kinetic energy given by h nu minus the binding energy of the electron. And you have to keep in mind that photoelectric effect cannot happen when the electron is free. When the electron is free, the photoelectric effect cannot happen. So the photoelectric effect always occurs. It always occurs on the bound electrons, only on the bound electrons. Like in this case, the electron was bound with the nucleus, and over here the electrons are bound with the surface of the conductor. So the photoelectric effect always occurs on the bound electrons. And why does this happen? This happens to conserve the momentum and energy, to conserve the linear momentum and energy. The photoelectric effect always occurs with the bound electrons. If you try to solve the photoelectric effect in the case of free electron, in that case you won't be able to conserve momentum and energy, because as we have said that electron is bound with the nucleus. So in this case, nucleus is required. The nucleus is required to absorb the recoil momentum. So you already know what is the recoil momentum. So the momentum, a part of the momentum of the photon is given to the electron, and the rest must be given to the second body, and that is nucleus in this case. So that is the recoil momentum. So nucleus must be present to absorb the recoil momentum. So this is why the photoelectric effect cannot happen with the free electrons. The theory of the photoelectric effect that has been given in the book by modern publications, that you have to do by yourself. Like for example, the Einstein's photoelectric equation. So this you have already done many times, and you have done it in your high school also. Then you did it in the quantum mechanics. So this you have to do by yourself. And after that, the experimental verification. So this experiment you have already done number of times before, so you have to do its theory by yourself. And after this, the graph of stopping power, the stopping potential and the frequency. So this you also have to do by yourself. And you also have to do the graph of current versus the retarding potential, keeping frequency constant. And the another graph that you have done is keeping the intensity of the light constant. So in the case when intensity is constant, you change the frequencies. Let's say you take nu 1, nu 2, nu 3. So that you have to plot. And when frequency is constant, in that case you differ the intensities. Let's say you take I1, I2 and I3 of same frequency, and then you plot the graph of current versus the retarding potential. So these topics you have to do by yourself. Now we are going to see that how the cross-section of the photoelectric effect varies with the energy. So what is the behavior of the cross-section of the photoelectric effect with energy, with the change in energy? Now what is cross-section? Cross-section tells us the probability of any process or any reaction to happen. So cross-section of a photoelectric effect gives us the probability of the photoelectric effect to happen. So here we are going to see that how the cross-section behaves with the change in energy of the photon, of the incoming photon. So a free electron cannot absorb a photon, as we know that free electron cannot absorb a photon and also conserve the momentum at the same time. So if the free electron absorbs a photon, it won't be able to conserve momentum. So a free electron cannot cause photoelectric effect. The photoelectric effect always occurs on the bound electrons, and that's because nucleus is present in that case to absorb the recoil momentum. Therefore, the photoelectric effect always occurs with the bound electrons. Now let's say I have some atom. I have an atom over here. So there is a nucleus and there are electrons which are revolving around the nucleus in different orbits. So the innermost orbit, the innermost shell is called as the K shell. The innermost shell, which is the closest to the nucleus, is called as the K shell. Then we have the second shell, which is named as L shell. And then so on, we have M shell, N shell, and so on. Now you already know that the electrons which are closer to the nucleus, they have maximum binding energy. The electrons which are present in the K shell, these are the closest to the nucleus. Therefore, more energy will be required to make them unbound, to make them free from the force of the nucleus. So more energy will be required. So as you are moving away from the nucleus, lesser amount of energy will be required to make those electrons unbound. And in the case of K shell, the electrons require maximum amount of binding energy. Maximum amount of energy is required to make them unbound. Then for the case of L shell electrons, binding energy will be less than that of the K shell electrons. So there will be a binding energy, there will be certain amount of energy that must be required to make the electrons of the L shell, to make them unbound, but that energy will be less than the energy required for the case of K shell electrons. And similarly, for the case of M shell electrons, the energy required will be even less than the L shell and K shell electrons. So I mean to say that as we are moving closer to the nucleus, the energy required for the electrons to make them unbound will be increasing, that increases. So we are going to see that how the cross section of the photoelectric effect behaves with the changing energy of the incoming photon. So in this case, let's say I have a photon of energy which is exactly equal to the energy of the electrons in the M shell. So in every shell, the electrons have certain amount of energy. So the photon which I am making, I'm making this photon to strike on this atom, this photon has certain amount of energy, and let's suppose that energy of the photon, the incoming photon, is exactly equal to the binding energy of the M shell electrons. So we are just supposing that energy of this incoming photon is exactly equal to the binding energy of the M shell electrons. In that particular case, what happens is that the probability of M shell electrons to get ejected out of this atom will be maximum. So when the energy of the incoming photon is equal to the binding energy of the electrons of the M shell, in that case, the M shell, probability of the M shell electrons to get ejected out will be more. So obviously, if the photon, this photon has energy exactly equal to the binding energy of M shell electron, so this photon won't be able to eject the electrons of the L shell or M shell, because we know that energy required to eject the electrons of L shell and K shell is very large as compared to the energy required to eject the electrons of the M shell electrons. So we know that binding energy of electrons of K shell is greater than the binding energy of the electrons for L shell, and this is greater than the binding energy of the electrons in M shell, and so on. So I am saying that when the energy of the incoming photon is equal to binding energy of the electrons in the M shell, so that is equal to binding energy of the electrons in the M shell, in that case, this photon won't be able to eject the L shell or K shell electrons. It won't be able to eject the L shell and K shell electrons because its energy is less than the binding energy of the electron of L shell and also less than the binding energy of the K shell electron. Therefore, in that case, this photon would be able to eject the electrons of M shell only. And as the energy of the incoming photon is increased. As you keep on increasing the energy of the incoming photon, so one point will come when the energy of this photon will be equal to the binding energy of the electrons in the L shell. So earlier the energy of this photon was assumed to be equal to the binding energy of M shell. Now you are increasing the energy of the incoming photon. So one point will come when the energy of the incoming photon will be equal to the energy of the binding energy of the electrons in the L shell. In that case, probability of the L shell electrons to get ejected out will be more. And similar is the case with the K shell electrons. When you further increase the energy of the incoming photon, and when this energy becomes equal to the binding energy of the electrons of the K shell, because binding energy of K shell is maximum, it is greater than that of L shell and even greater than that of the M shell. So we are increasing the energy of the photon, and one point will come when its energy will be equal to the binding energy of the K shell electron. In that case, probability of emission of K shell electron will be more. So it has been seen that at energies above the highest electron binding energy of the atom. So in this case, what is the highest binding energy? That is for the case of K shell. So for the case of K shell, the binding energy is maximum. At energies above the highest electron binding energies, when the energy of the incoming photon is greater than the binding energy of K shell electron. So here we have discussed about the energy equal to binding energy of M shell, then it was equal to the binding energy of L shell, and after that it was assumed to be equal to the binding energy of K shell. Now we are saying that the energy of this photon is even greater than the binding energy of the K shell electron. So what happens in that case is that it has been seen that at energies above the highest electron binding energy, means the K shell, when the energy of the photon is even greater than the binding energy of the K shell electron, in that case the cross section of the photoelectric effect, the probability of the photoelectric effect is relatively small. When the energy of this photon is large as compared to the binding energy of the K shell electron, because binding energy of the K shell is highest from all, and if the photon's energy is even greater than the binding energy of the K shell electron, in that case the cross section of the photoelectric effect is relatively small. It is small, as you can see over here. So in this graph, I have on the horizontal axis I have energy and it is taken in mega electron volts, and on the vertical axis I have the cross section of the reaction, and in this case it is the cross section of the photoelectric effect, and this is in bonds. So this is in bonds. So this is a unit of cross section. So in this direction the energy is increasing, and in this direction the cross section of the reaction is increasing. So you can see that when the energy of the photon is very large at this point, when the energy of the photon is very large as compared to the binding energy of the K shell electron, because the binding energy of the K shell electron is the generally it is in kilo electron volts. The materials that we use to study photoelectric effect, in those cases the binding energy of the K shell electron is in kilo electron volts. So here I have 10 power 2 mega electron volts. So this energy 10 power 2 mega electron volt at this point is very large as compared to the binding energy of the K shell electron. So when the energy is very large as compared to the binding energy of the K shell electron, in that case the cross section of photoelectric effect, or you can say the probability of photoelectric effect, is very small. And as the energy is decreased, as energy decreases, the energy of the incoming photon is decreased, the cross section increases. So as you decrease the energy of the incoming photon, so in this direction the energy of the incoming photon is decreased. So as you are decreasing the energy of the photon, the cross section of the photoelectric effect increases. So the cross section is relatively small at energies above the highest electron binding energy, but this cross section increases rapidly. So you can see that the cross section increases rapidly as the K shell energy is approached. So at this point, this point on the horizontal axis, it corresponds to the binding energy of the K shell electron. So when the energy of the photon is greater than the binding energy of the K shell electron, you can see that the cross section of the photoelectric effect was very small. And as the energy is decreased, energy of the incoming photon is decreased, the cross section of the photoelectric effect increases rapidly as the K shell energy is approached. So as the energy of the incoming photon is approaching the energy of the binding energy of the K shell electron, the cross section increases rapidly. The cross section of photoelectric effect increases rapidly as the K shell energy is approached. And just below this point, the cross section drops drastically. So you can see that earlier, when the energy was decreased, the photoelectric effect cross section increased rapidly as the binding energy of the photon's energy was approaching the binding energy of the K shell electron. But just below this energy, when the energy of the photon becomes just less than the binding energy of the K shell electron, in that case, the K shell electron won't be ejected in that case. When the energy of the photon is less than the binding energy of the K shell electron, in that case, the K shell electron won't be ejected at all, because at least this much energy is required to eject the K shell electrons. But here we are talking about just below this point, below the binding energy of the K shell electron, what happens that the K shell electron won't be able to eject. So in that case, we get a sharp dip. So the cross section drops drastically. The probability of the photoelectric effect in that case drops drastically. So the cross section has dropped drastically. So just after this point, just below the binding energy of the K shell electron, the cross section drops drastically, since the K electrons are no longer available for the photoelectric effect, because now the photoelectric effect cannot happen for the case of K shell electrons. Therefore, there is a sharp dip in the cross section just below the binding energy of the K shell electron. So this drop is known as K absorption edge. So this peak that you get, this is called as K absorption edge. And after this point, so when you further decrease the energy, so what you are doing is decreasing the energy of the incoming photon. As you were decreasing its energy, the cross section increased rapidly, and it reached a peak when the energy of the incoming photon is equal to the binding energy of the K shell electron. And after that, when the energy of the photon is decreased further, after that there was a sharp dip. The cross section decreased drastically. Now what happens after that, when you further decrease the energy of the incoming photon, the cross section increases rapidly. Again, there is an increase in the cross section. Because now L shell electrons will be ejected out instead of K shell. So now L shell electrons will be available to get ejected out. So the photon's energy is decreased further, and one point will reach. So this point corresponding to the second peak. So this was the first peak which was obtained. Now we get a second peak, and this corresponds to the binding energy of the electron in the L shell. So we are decreasing the energy of incoming photon, and we know that binding energy of K shell electron is more than the binding energy of the L shell electron. So when you are decreasing the energy of the incoming photon further, the cross section will increase, it will rise, and again it will reach a peak. And after that, there will be again a sharp tip. So again after that, there will be a sharp tip, like in this case. So this peak, this second peak that you obtain, this is called as the L absorption edge. So below this energy, below the binding energy of the K shell electron, the cross section rises once again. So there is again a rise in the cross section and dips again. So there is again a sharp dip. And these dips that you get, these are corresponding to L, M, N, and so on. So when these L, M, N shells, these are passed, when their energies are passed, the cross section again rises and again there is a dip. So you can see that again there is a rise and again there is a dip. You get L absorption edge, and again there is a rise, then again there is a dip. So as the L, M, N shells energies are passed, we get the same trend. So there is a rise, then there is a decrease, there is a rise, then there is a decrease. So we get a dip. So we keep on getting the peaks. And this second peak is called as the L absorption edge. Then this third peak that you get over here, this will be called as M absorption edge. So this corresponds to the binding energy of the M shell. So this point corresponds to the binding energy of the M shell. So these are known as the L absorption edge, M absorption edge respectively. So corresponding to the binding energy, when the energy of the incoming photon is equal to the binding energy of L shell electron, the peak that you get is called as L absorption edge. And again, if you further decrease the energy of the incoming photon, you get another peak corresponding to the energy of the photon when it is equal to the binding energy of M shell. And that corresponding peak is called as the M absorption edge. In the next lecture, we will discuss about the Compton scattering, that how the gamma photon interacts with the free electron via Compton scattering. So that we will discuss in the next lecture.